All right, so we're going to start talking about geometric dimensioning and tolerancing. So let's start here with a drawing that doesn't have any GD&T on it. So what we have is a block that's 5 inches wide, 3 inches, 5 inches long, 3 inches wide, and 3/4 of an inch thick. I don't have the whole dimension. I have that on there because later on I'll show you a real block, and that's to kind of get your bearings on where that block is located. Of course, you know, we could dimension that, but I just want to pay attention right now to the outside dimensions of this block. So if we have these outside dimensions, then we could take a height gauge or some calipers and see if the block falls within those dimensions. All right, so we can get our height gauge out, set this part down on a surface plate. So this surface plate's a really nice planar surface, very, very close to being planar. It has very small, very little deviation in it. We can come in here with this height gauge and set down, and we can compare the height of this block to the tolerances on our print. So if it falls between the 3.01 and 2.99 inches, then it will be considered to be in tolerance. All right, so it's real easy to kind of get this idea that the block only has size, okay? And that's kind of the impression that you get when you evaluate things based on these size tolerances, these tolerance of these features of size, as they're called. That is the length and the width, the diameter of a hole. Those are features of size, things that you could put a caliper or height gauge down on and measure them dimensionally. But what it doesn't really take into account, it does, but it doesn't do it very well, and that is the geometry of the part, because you see, real parts don't look like this. They look more like this, okay? So they have this this irregular geometry, and you may not think of parts like this, but if you live and work in a machine shop for very long, you will understand that parts are not perfect. They don't have this sort of idealized geometry. They have real or actual geometry. They have actual sizes, and they have actual shape. Okay, so what we want to do is talk about how do you control the shape, the geometry of these parts. So one way that really the one thing that's controlling the geometry of the block that we've made and that we're evaluating is a couple of planes that get set up. So let me pop those planes in there. These planes, these are the 0.75 inches plus or minus the tolerance. Okay, and they're actually exaggerated a little bit so you can see them a little bit easier. But when you look at this irregular geometry, as long as it falls within those bounds, then it's considered to be in tolerance. You see, we haven't said anything at all about what the shape of the surface should look like. The closest that we may have gotten to this would be with surface roughness symbols and limiting the surface roughness. But this actually goes beyond that. This is the shape of the part. So, it's unlikely that the designer of this part, when they designed it with this tolerance, considered that maybe the part wouldn't just be the wrong size, or maybe it wouldn't just be within some limited size, but maybe this shape might be totally unacceptable, even though it may fall within the boundary set up by the tolerance. Now again, that would be this tolerance. So here's the 0.75 plus or minus the 0.01. That is what's setting up that the boundary that is controlling the geometry. Well, it might be, in fact it's commonly the case, that we are concerned with the shape and we don't want to have a part that has all of that aberrant geometry on it. We want a nice flat part. But we're not so concerned with the size of the part. You see, the only way that we can tighten up that tolerance with this type of dimension is to come in here and make this. You see, we'd have to tighten this up. We'd have to make this tolerance you know, 10 times tighter if we want to not have, you know, for example, to not have all of that variation in the geometry. So if this is the only tool that we're using, then we have to make this tolerance really, really tight to tighten up with those planes that are defining the geometry of this part. So if we're trying to control the shape with the tolerance, then it's kind of the wrong tool for the job, because now to tighten up on the shape, to make the shape more consistent, we have to have a really tight tolerance on the size. And in reality, they're two separate things. We've got the size tolerance is one thing, but we want the shape of the part needs to be defined another way. And that's where the geometric dimensioning and tolerancing comes in. So let me just start here with rule number one, because that's kind of what I've been talking about. All right, so here's rule number one. Where only a tolerance of size is specified, the limits of size of an individual feature prescribe the extent to which variations in its geometric form as well as its size are allowed. So what that's saying is that if you don't have a geometric tolerance, if it's not present, then the limits of the size of the part are also doing the job of controlling the form of the part. And so that actually kind of works both ways, and that is that it permits variation, but it also controls variation. So it means that let's go back out and look at this. So that what that means is that it's since it permits variation, that means that it can move, that the features, that the surface of the part, the shape of the part, can move to fit within this bound. But as soon as it goes outside of this boundary, like it does down here, then it's out of tolerance. Okay, so rule number one allows variation in between the tolerance zone, and it prohibits variation outside of it. So that's rule number one, and that's the rule if we and of course this thing fails miserably, if we only have these rectangular dimensions, that's the only tool that we have, then we can control the geometry. So we can do GD&T without GD&T, but it's like a blunt instrument. See, what we'd like to be able to do is make this part inexpensive to make. That is, we'd like for the people making the part to be able to make it as cheaply as possible. That is, they might be able to just come in here and mill it flat, and as long as it's nice and flat, we're not too concerned with the size. And what we want to be able to do is separate our control of the size of the part and allow something like a nice, generous tolerance on the size of the part, but also separately control the shape of the part. So we want it to be nice and flat. We want to allow a generous tolerance, but we'd like for it to be nice and flat. Okay, so that takes us to kind of where we want to start off here. Okay, so the deal with GD&T is, the whole purpose of GD&T is to describe the design intent. That is, you want a part to function a certain way, and you need it to be flat or parallel, or things need to be in the right position to within certain bounds in order for the part to function properly. All right, so GD&T is a very nice, succinct language. It all means something very precise, and there's not any extra information in the symbols. Okay, so you're trying to ask for something very precisely, and sometimes this gets people into a little bit of trouble because they want a symbol to mean something that maybe it doesn't mean. By the way, I don't have the standard written down, but it's probably on here somewhere. But what we're talking about, at least in the United States in general, is ASMEY 14.5, the Geometric Dimensioning and Tolerancing Standard. And that is what spells out how to interpret all of these symbols. There are also ISO standards that do the same job. All right, so trying to convey this kind of information by typing it in notes Really, you know, you could have done that once upon a time, but it's not nearly as succinct, and the language, it would just be a perpetual argument trying to pick apart what those notes meant. It's a nice graphical language, can be used internationally. I'm going to skip past this example and jump right in here, because this is kind of similar to what we were talking about, okay? And this is just an illustration. Don't take the standard, like the way that the decimal places and stuff like that are on here. I haven't cleaned that up. But anyway, let's take this table, for instance. Okay, so we're going to go into the business making these tables, and we're trying to provide a nice generous tolerance on the height of the table. Okay, so we'll tell our wood shop that it can be 15 inches tall, plus or minus a half an inch. All right, well, since there's no separate dimension on the geometry, there's no geometric tolerance on this, then the only thing that's controlling the geometry is the tolerance. Okay, the tolerance on the feature of size, that is the overall height of this thing. So we've got half an inch, plus or minus half an inch along the top of this table. What that means is that this, according to rule number one, would be in tolerance. It falls within the tolerance on the feature of size. So what GD&T will allow us to do is to separate out those two things. We can still say we want the height to be plus or minus a half an inch, but we now limit the flatness of the table to within 0.2 inches. All right, so that's a separate thing, different and distinct from the tolerance on the feature of size. All right, so now I'll scroll back here. This is kind of where GD&T came from, and that is that here we're trying to control the position of this hole. Okay, so in this case, we've said that the hole, it's a 1.25 inch diameter, and it needs to be 1 inch from one surface and 1 inch from the other surface, plus or minus 0.01. And if you ask yourself, well, how far out of tolerance could that make that hole position be? How far from the actual target could what's the worst case scenario? You think, well, maybe it's 0.01 because it looks like we've limited that deviation to 0.01 inches. When in fact, if we zoom in here, there's our 0.01, but notice this, that the hole can actually be 0.014 inches out of tolerance, out of position. And like I said, this is kind of where GD&T came from, is my understanding that there were it was a torpedo factory, and they had a tolerance on these parts, and they were having to scrap parts that were in this kind of condition because, well, let's see, they'd have to scrap a part that was maybe 0.014 inches out of tolerance in this direction. Let me get my pointer turned on there. So it may have been 0.013 or 0.012 inches out of tolerance in this direction, which they would have to scrap that part. But if it was even worse deviation in this direction, say 0.0140, then it would be in tolerance. And so there was this discrepancy, and probably the guy had OCD, and it was probably just driving him nuts. Actually, what's more likely is that he wasn't making his production numbers, and they were having to scrap parts, and he was probably pretty upset because there was this this sort of hypocrisy that if a part's out of tolerance in this direction, it would be scrapped, but if it was out of tolerance in this direction, it would be acceptable. And you know, it's the proverbial square peg in the round hole. You can fit a square peg in a round hole, but it's not efficient. All right. So what tolerance, what GD&T will typically do is set up these tolerance zones. And part of understanding GD&T is in part kind of understanding what the shape of the tolerance zone is for the tolerance that you're specifying. We'll also use these things called datums. And the datums are going to help us to locate a part and locate these tolerance zones systematically. Okay, so let's look at the feature control frame. So the feature control frame is sort of the primary place where we request a geometric tolerance. All right, so first there's going to be a symbol in this frame. Then there's going to be sometimes optionally a zone descriptor. In this case, it's saying the zone is a diameter, and this is the geometric tolerance. We'll talk a little bit about what that number means. That's not plus or minus. That is the size of the tolerance zone. So in this case, the tolerance zone has a 0.06 inch diameter. This is an example of a material condition symbol. We'll talk about what that means. And then out here, we are defining the datums that help to position that tolerance zone. Let's see, I'm getting a little bit of stuffed blood off of there. All right, so there's the geometric characteristic symbol. Here are some geometric characteristic symbols. So concentricity, I think, in this latest version of the standard has finally been retired. There's a lot of confusion over what concentricity meant. Circularity, straightness, parallelism, and we'll talk about a bunch of these, and you'll kind of get the idea of what's going on, and that's kind of what's important, is to understand how this stuff works. All right, I think we talked about that. Okay, so this number right here, in this case, this is a diameter. If the diameter symbol is not missing there, then what we're talking about is the full indicator movement, okay, or total indicator movement, TIM, total indicator reading sometimes, TIR, or full indicator movement, FIM. They're all talking about the same thing. And that is, you take a dial indicator like this and sweep it across the surface that you're trying to evaluate, and this, the amount of sweep, not the plus or minus, but the overall distance that this dial indicator sweeps is the full indicator movement. That's generally what's in the feature control frame there. If you're not sure what a dial indicator is, the Suburban Tools has a real nice video on how to set up and use a dial test indicator. All right, so here's an example of a dial indicator, and what we're evaluating in this case is something called perpendicularity. That is how perpendicular this side number two is to side number one. And what we've done is we've laid side number one down on this surface plate, and we're going to drag this indicator across the surface. Well, Google Photos is having trouble playing the video, so we're just going to do it as a still shot here. So let's just say, for example, that the indicator swept all the way to here and here. So the indicator moved back and forth across this section right here from 10 to 10. Okay, so all right, so we just set this thing down, and that's the most movement that we got out of this. So it might be tempting to call that 20 thou or something. Each one of these, by the way, of the larger marks is 1 thou, 0.001. So that would be 5 thou there. So from this 10 to the 5 to this 10, that overall is 10 thou. Okay, so don't get tied down to the numbers. Get tied down to the number of marks. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And we're talking about the large marks. This has a half thou mark on here. Okay, so that would be 10 thou total indicator reading. All right, you'll also see these zone modifiers. This is maximum material condition. I'm going to punt and talk about that a little bit later. But we'll move down here. We'll talk about the datums. So this is calling out the datums. Sometimes these are planar datums. Sometimes they're axes. But the sequence that they're listed in this feature control frame matters. And all right, so for instance, if we have this particular feature control frame, it's asking for this to be relative to datum A, then datum B, then datum C. And what that means is that we place the part against datum A first of all, and then slide it over to B. So we will get a different position, whoops, if we slide it against B and then slide down to A. Now, sometimes you may need to put a theoretical plane somewhere in space in order to ask for a position to be made. And what you'll see there a lot of times is this basic dimension. That is a dimension that is in a rectangle like this, in a little box. So one of the things that people struggle with when they see these basic dimensions, what this is doing is this is setting up a theoretical point in real space. So one way to sort of simulate this might be to take a surface plate and stack gauge blocks on them until it's 4.7 millimeters tall, and that would set up this distance. Some people make the mistake of understanding this, there's not a tolerance associated with this basic dimension. Because what it's doing is trying to simulate a position in real life, and then later, somewhere else on the drawing, you will find the tolerance for something as how much it can deviate from this particular distance or this place. So this is a basic dimension. It does not have a tolerance because it is you're going to set it up with sort of gauge block accuracy, a position that's going to simulate a theoretically perfect dimension. Well, let's see. You can also have axis datums, and in this case, we've been careful to align the datum identifier, that's this A right here, with the dimension. And what that's setting up is the axis through this part. And you might say, well, shouldn't you just apply that axis datum identifier to the axis here? And the reason that you don't is really well explained in this little video here. I will just get enough information for you to link out there to it. Well, that's not it. Let's come out here. All right, so this is Tech Ease. Features have axes, so that's a real good explanation of it. Essentially, you know, if you consider that you had multiple diameters on here, all right. So say you had two different diameters on this part, then you might get in an actual part they might each have their own axis of rotation. If you were to take and clamp down on this surface in a collet and do something like measure run out on this surface, you'll get a different reading than if you were to clamp down on this other axis. So they don't have the same axis. They don't share the same axis. And of course, this is greatly exaggerated. They may appear to have something like the same axis, but they're distinct. And so you introduce a chance for error there. If you just ask for this to be the axis, even though it seems theoretically on a perfect part, it would all be the same axis. You know, it would all go just straight through the part like this. But in reality, if you were to position, clamp down, hold the part by this, you'd get a different reading than if you were to hold it by the other cylinder. Okay, so we're going to have a look probably at what's the simplest group of geometric controls, and those are the form controls. All right, so form relates to the shape of the part itself. These are the form controls. Straightness, flatness, circularity, and cylindricity. So they're not relative to anything else. So a surface is either flat or it's not. It doesn't matter what the adjacent surfaces or the opposing surfaces may be. It is either flat or it's not flat unto itself. All right, so if you see datums attached to any of these form controls, then there's something wrong. All right, so first of all, straightness. This is a dry erase marker, and if you look at it in this image here, you can see some daylight in between it and this surface plate. So it is not a straight part. Of course, there's no truly straight part, but this one has enough variation that it's pretty easy to see. All right, I'm gonna try to get a screen grab here so I can write on this thing. So the straightness, and this part here doesn't look straight at all unless we look at it in this direction. So in this direction, this part has pretty good straightness. So these GD&T symbols, when we attach them, they're going to actually have some direction involved to them. So in this direction, the part is straight. But in this other direction, it does not have straightness. Same thing down here. This part is straight in this direction, but in this other direction it is not straight. All right, so here is an image of, this is sort of an exaggerated part that's made to test the bounds of the straightness tolerance. We have two different things going on here. We have the diameter tolerance of this cylinder shape, and we have applied to it a straightness tolerance. Okay, so the straightness, as long as, so the green cylinder here is the tolerance zone for the size of the cylinder, that is the 2.1 to 2.11 inches in diameter. That is set up, that's our rule number one tolerance. First of all, if we didn't have this straightness tolerance on here, then the part would have to be straight within the green zone there. So as long as all of the diameters fit in that green zone, then it passes this test. But we've added this additional requirement of straightness to the part. So this straightness band is two-dimensional, and it can float around as long as the part fits inside of the green boundary. So the straightness will see abrupt changes in diameter. So if we, you know, if we had a giant change in diameter, that would fail the straightness test. But this one, whoops, has been designed, you know, this part is pushing the bounds of that straightness tolerance. So it still falls within the tolerance, but it's right up against the edge. So it's kind of filling the entire straightness tolerance zone. All right, so this part, in this case, here you can see the zone set up by that straightness tolerance. So I should say that the straightness doesn't care if this part's tapered or not. It doesn't see the taper. You see, it can float around. And so being a tapered part is not going to make the straightness, make it fail the straightness test. It will, as long as it fits, the taper fits in a nice straight line, then it won't see taper at all. So I did say that the straightness has a direction to it. If you look at this image, both of these, you know, this part down here could conceivably pass this test, because here in this direction, when we see this point 3, we're talking about the straightness along this axis, and here at the point 1 we see it along the long axis, and so this part's relatively, you know, really very straight in this direction, that's the point 01 direction, but it's starting to push the bounds of the point 3 dimension. So this little bit of wiggle in here is starting to push the bounds. So this part could be fine. Now, if the corrugations were reversed, if they were rotated 90 degrees, it would fail this outright. But there is a direction to the symbols. All right, now flatness is kind of the next step in straightness, kind of the next development. So this is going to apply only to a planar surface. If you have any other shape, this is, you know, it's going to fail outright. But if you have this planar surface, then we're dealing with flatness. Now, the flatness tolerance is not the same thing as parallelism. Let me make that point. Let me just get an example here. Okay, if I had this kind of setup here, and I've got my dial indicator set on this surface plate, and I'm sliding around, people get the idea that that's measuring flatness, and it's not. What this is measuring is parallelism. It's measuring how parallel this side is to the other side. You see, if I wanted to measure flatness, let's say I was trying to measure flatness doing this, I would be totally within my rights to set this on a piece of shim stock or something to try to eliminate some of this indicator movement. You see, if I see that it's indicating a lot left to right, but it looks relatively flat, I might decide to stick this up on a little bit of shim stock to measure flatness. But if I really need to measure flatness, whoops, wrong. Well, I should go ahead and play this, because this is looking at straightness across the surface of this block. So I have a guide set up. I'm going to set up a guide here and then slide the part back and forth. And I have an indicator that's poking up through the bottom of this table. And as it moves, yeah, get my hand out of the way. As it moves, you can see this is evaluating the straightness on that block. If I were moving this in two dimensions, back and forth, left and right, then I would be looking at the flatness of that surface. So this video, this one shows, let me just back that up again. This one shows the setup. Okay, so we have a hole. We've got a nice flat surface here. We've got our indicator underneath here. And as we drag back and forth, left and right, in and out, then we're evaluating the flatness of this side. It doesn't matter what's going on the other side. You see, this side's going to measure terribly when we evaluate the flatness. The opposite side here is going to have pretty good flatness characteristics to it. If we were measuring the parallelism like we were just a minute ago with this sitting down on a surface plate, that might tip this thing way out of whack. Okay, so it may not be parallel, but it's pretty flat unto itself. And so it's important to understand the distinction between those two. I'll just go ahead and play this because in this case, this is measuring straightness in this direction on the part. And we would do this in several locations across the face of the part, finding it at least the most likely position that would throw it out of tolerance. Okay, so if we look at this part, we see that this surface is nice and flat. The bottom of this surface is nice and flat. It does not matter what's going on the other side. Okay, and so that's the distinction between flatness and parallelism. Here is what the tolerance zone for flatness looks like. First of all, we have the tolerance of size. That's what's shown in green. So the designer of this part has asked for it to be maybe 1 inch plus or minus a quarter of an inch or some nice wide tolerance in this dimension. And then separately, they have attached a flatness tolerance to this part. So it must fit, the flatness part must fit within the little blue zone. And that blue zone can float up and down and it can tilt, but it has to remain two-dimensionally flat across this surface and that surface. And again, this part is designed to kind of push the boundary of that flatness, but it falls within. So the flatness doesn't see the fact that this surface is tilted. Remember, it doesn't have anything to do with parallelism. It doesn't have anything to do with the backside of this. As long as it fits within the size tolerance, and as long as you can find a set of parallel planes that you can shrink down onto the variation, and those two planes be less than the tolerance apart, then it's considered flat. All right, you can get flatness other ways. Okay, so if you ask for parallelism, that's probably the easiest way to see that you have to, that for two parts to be parallel, two surfaces to be parallel, then the one that you're evaluating has to be flat. So if you're getting indicator movement on that part, it can come from the flatness. And these others, you'll see that as we go along. We've already seen it as a result from rule number one. That was our first example of the table. We said that the table, that rule number one, the dimensions, the tolerance of size, was controlling the tolerance of the form of the part as well as the size. So here's, again, this is just sort of a schematic of the way that we were inspecting flatness in the video. We've got an indicator coming up through the surface, and what that does is that limits, the only thing you're inspecting is that surface unto itself. All right, so circularity is kind of the round version of flatness. Here you can see these two parts. Both of these parts have pretty excellent roundness. They don't have good straightness. Well, this one has good straightness. This one doesn't have good straightness at all, but it has excellent roundness. So in this dimension, we can evaluate these separately here and here and here. Each one of these, if I were to take a cross section through here, they would each be nice and round. So even this one is not straight, however. It's also doesn't have good cylindricities. Cylindricity is kind of the three-dimensional corollary of circularity. This part, excellent straightness and excellent roundness, or at least good straightness and good roundness. They're not thrown out by any this taper. Straightness doesn't see a taper. Roundness doesn't see a taper, but cylindricity will see a taper. So cylindricity would set up a sort of a three-dimensional tolerance zone that would have a be the shape of a perfect cylinder, and as this thing starts to deviate out of that zone, it would fail the inspection. Here are some roundness tolerance zones. It's a series of these two-dimensional zones up and down the length of the part. Okay, so this part is nowhere close to failing roundness. This part has perfect roundness, just about. It has lousy cylindricity, lousy straightness, but it has near perfect roundness. This part is starting to test the limits of roundness. So here's our tolerance zone in here, and of course we slide this zone back and forth in and out of here at each individual spot. If it's roundness, we reset it at each of these spots where we move it along the axis. This part's starting to fail. No way is this part going to fail roundness. It is round all the way up and down itself. Now, cylindricity is going to lock in a little bit more. So now this tolerance zone has to be, cannot have any kind of taper to it. So it has to be straight and round at the same time, and it cannot vary the diameter. The size can vary within the green zone, but the shape, the cylindricity, is limited by this little light blue zone in here. And you can see it's kind of testing the bounds of that cylindricity tolerance. All right, so those are the form tolerances. Let's take a look at the orientation controls. So these are always going to require some kind of a reference, because you can't be oriented unto yourself. You have to be oriented compared to something else. So these are the orientation controls: parallelism, perpendicularity, and angularity. So these always use some kind of a datum. All right, so in this case, we're inspecting perpendicularity of this surface, and it is relative to this datum. So we have this surface of the angled part resting against what's going to become this datum. So this would be called out as basically datum A, and this side would be perpendicular relative to datum A. And we'd have this this tolerance zone in here that would look like that. Angularity, same kind of idea. We have an angled surface that is angled relative to some other surface. And again, the value that's in here is the total indicator reading. So even though we're dealing with an angle, we're not going to tolerance it with some part of a degree. That's much harder to inspect. What we will do is we're going to inspect the total indicator reading as a value in inches, all right, or units of length. So this is angularity of this surface relative to datum A. So we would have to construct this, you know, there would be a dimension in here that would tell us what the angle was that we had to be constructing. So maybe 30 degrees. We would have to construct a sine bar set up like this, and then we would drag our indicator on the surface plate and be evaluating the movement in this plane up here. And then parallelism, which probably should be the first slide in this group, we've already kind of seen. We set the part down on this surface plate. The surface plate will simulate datum A for us. So we set this thing down onto that surface plate and evaluate how much this side deviates from datum A. So it's important to remember that datum A is not the other side of this, okay? Datum A is the surface plate that we rest that other side against. All right, and then location controls. So these are going to control, as you might expect, the location. The position is the most commonly used one of these. And like I said, concentricity has been canceled in the latest edition. It's my understanding. All right, so let's look at position. So in order to establish that a hole is in the right place, we have to establish what that target place is, what that true position is. And that's what we're doing here. We're saying that these six holes have to be, first of all, we give their diameter tolerance here. So this is the size control. It has nothing to do with the position in this case. Here we're calling out the position of these holes. So they have to be situated to within 0.050 inches with respect to the targets constructed around datum B. So we have datum B is going to establish the center of this array of holes. Notice that's going to give us different results than if we were on a real actual part, if we centered our datum on the disk that the holes are actually drilled in. So very important distinction there. We're saying center that location, center those hole locations around datum B. And here are some basic dimensions. Construct this circle that has a diameter of 150 millimeters. And we're going to have six of these holes 60 degrees apart. So these are basic dimensions. That means that there is no tolerance attached to these. So these could exist if we were using like a vision CMM or just a CMM. Then we could construct an idealized target for these. Here you see that target laid out. And so these intersections are the true position of those holes. And then at each of those intersections, there is this tolerance zone. So where did that come from? That is this 50 thou. Okay, so this 50 thou diameter, there's our diameter symbol, is the amount of tolerance that each holes have around their true position. So the true position laid out by our basic dimensions to establish this target, then our 50 thou tolerance zone that runs the depth of that hole. And you can see this is the hole center for this particular hole. It is pretty close to falling out of tolerance. But that's what we're looking at. You can see this hole is actually out of tolerance. It's shifted away from where its true position needs to be. All right, so I'll just mention concentricity because you may still come across it. It is perfectly valid in the 1994 standard. But what it means is something may not be what you think it means, just kind of like in The Princess Bride. But anyway, what we're saying is, you know, you might think this is, just talking about the position where you evaluate something like this center axis to that center axis. What it's actually doing is looking at the center point at two diametrically opposed sides of this surface. So if this were if this shape here were a circle, if it was a cylinder shape, the way that I've modeled this is it would be perfectly concentric with this other shape, with the datum here. But this shape has some lobes to it. So if you had very common for shafts sometimes to take on sort of a trilobal shape, if you had those lobes, those would shift the concentricity out of whack, out of position, even if the tri-lobed part were perfectly centered on the other cylinder. So in this case, this has like seven different sides, and that means that each center point is shifted over just a little bit. If you look from this side to the corresponding flat, that means it's been shifted a little bit toward the pointy end. And these are all the center axes that would be inspected. So you're looking all the way across and finding the midpoint and evaluating all of those. All right, so maybe that lets you know a little bit about why concentricity is no longer used. It was always better to just call out a position tolerance. I'll ask for give some true position based on this datum than to call it concentricity. This is what you might imagine concentricity working as, and this one is the two shafts are not quite concentric, and it's falling out of, or almost falling out of tolerance because of the actual position. But it's possible to be perfectly positioned and have it fail concentricity because of the shape. All right, so that's all I'm going to put into this lecture. Just stay tuned, maybe, and we'll do another one based on we'll talk about some of the material conditions, MMC and LMC, because MMC is a very important thing to understand for the purposes of tool design, which is what I'm doing this lecture for.